for this session is Parivar Aur Samskar. I will first deal with Samskar and then what is the role of Parivar in imparting Samskar. Then what is meant by Samskar? Adi Shankara ne Vedanta Sutra ke upar वो कमेंट्री लिखते हुए लिखा है संस्कारो नाम गुणादानेन दोषापनयनेन वा. संस्कार इज ए प्रोसेस बाय विच गुड क्वालिटीज आर जनरेटेड एंड बैड क्वालिटीज आर रिड्यूस्ड. दिस इज द डेफिनेशन ऑफ द वर्ड संस्कार. इट मस्ट फॉर्म पार्ट ऑफ एनी एजुकेशन नेशनल आवर नेशनल एजुकेशन सिस्टम इट मस्ट हैव. बट अनफॉर्चुनेटली आफ्टर इंडिपेंडेंस आवर नेशनल लीडर्स थॉट all our problems can be solved and happiness could be achieved by political power and money power. But without realizing for all our political and economic problems, ultimately this giving samskar to individual is the only solution. And without that, by mere political power and economic power, we cannot achieve happiness. And today we see the state of the nation. After more than 8-5 year plans today, though the nation has made certain economic progress, ultimately everywhere the degradation of moral values is to abysmal depth. The reason is we did not give attention to samskar. Then what is samskar? As I said, you must impart good qualities to individuals. That can be done only from childhood. And then only they can become better individuals. If there are better individuals, there will be better family. If there are better family, then only the better national life. All of us know the story of two parrots in Panchatantra. Born out of the same mother, one parrot is destined to go to Rishyashram, another go to a butcher's house. And naturally, the cultural heritage, cultural values transmitted to the one in butcher's house was that of violence, and one in Rishyashrama was one of noble values and noble qualities. Now therefore, imparting of good qualities to individual is called samskar. And from ancient times, great importance has been attached by our ancestors to imparting samskar. Now what is it that we have to impart? The cultural values which have been time tested and which are regarded as most essential for the happiness of the family, for the individual and the society or the nation as the case may be. Those qualities have to be generated. And unfortunately we forgot our cultural importance of our culture. Yesterday I had been to Sabarmati Ashram, which is the tapobhumi of Mahatma Gandhiji. I read one passage. I will read it for your information. And that gives us the real message what we have to do through samskar. Mahatma Gandhiji has said, "It is my firm opinion that no culture has treasure so rich as ours has. We have not recognized its value. If we do not follow our culture, we would be committing suicide as a people." That is what exactly. There has been attempt to commit suicide, but there are still people like us who are preventing the nation from committing suicide. Otherwise, that is what is happening. We all forget our cultural values and totally influenced by Western civilization. I don't call it culture because it is not correct to call it as culture at all. Now there is a message. Subhash Chandra Bose fought against political slavery, and in his life history it is recorded, a foreign author has recorded, "If India got freedom in 1947, the major credit must go to Subhash Chandra Bose." You know what a because he had that samskar of patriotism. When under certain political circumstances He went to Himachal Pradesh. My friend has explained it. Thereafter, he changed his name as Orlando Manzato. And incognito, he went to the Europe and then ultimately landed in Germany. And with the help of German nation, he wanted to liberate India. But by that time, the Second World War in Europe came to an end, and then he came to Japan. And you know, his journey from, it is called perilous journey from Germany to Japan, in a submarine he traveled. There was no hope of his reaching again Japan or any land. Anyway, he took the risk in a travel in submarine and came to Japan, and thereafter he wanted to liberate this country. And all that he sacrificed, because in the younger days he had that samskar of patriotism. So he was prepared to do any sacrifice for the sake of the motherland. And therefore, we have on one side the message of Mahatma Gandhi, and another side the great sacrifice made by Subhash Chandra Bose. And this venue, there will be the session which is being held during Netaji birth centenary year, and at a place which is the Tapobhumi of Mahatma Gandhi, has got a great significance. And then today's inauguration was, according to me, very significant. It was by Dr. Pranav Pandya and Mr. Patel, one representing Dharma, another representing Nirma. You must have read my article in Niti 2 months back. I have said Dharma is the detergent for today's politics. If the dirt that has been collected in our social, political, and economic life, that dirt can be removed only by dharma. Just as Nirma removes the dirt of a cloth, this dharma removes the dirt of social, political, and economic dirt which has collected in all these 5 years. Dharma has been our basic structure. Many people translate this word into religion. It is absolutely wrong translation. Dharma is... it is a name given in Sanskrit word which means a code of conduct for all human beings in every sphere of human activity for all times to come. It is called dharma. There are rules of dharma. I don't want to go into that because that will be going out of the subject. But I will certainly mention to few values of dharma, because why samskara means we have to inculcate or import those qualities into our younger generation. You know, just when if a stone is given to a sculptor, he can make it a fine idol, whether it is of Krishna or Lord Rama or whatever it is. Just like that, if a child is just like a raw material, and if that raw material, just as a stone, can be converted either as a weapon or as a idol, a boy can be converted into a terrorist or a man of bad character or of a good character. That is why it is said, amantra maksharam nasti, nasti moolam manaushadam, ayogya purusho nasti, yojakastatra durlabha. There is no man who is useless, but there is dearth of planners or depth of persons who are to impart samskar to an individual. That is the role Bharat Vikas Parishat has to play. And that is the role which every parivar has to do it. Bharat Vikas Parishat means, as an organization, we can't impart samskar. We have to impart samskar through the agency of individual and the family. That is why family is given a very pride of place in our society. You know, the concept of root. Recently, just 4 or 5 days back, I addressed a gathering of foreign students, and the name given to the symposium was Roots. And those boys and girls have come from different foreign countries. They are all Indians, but for 2 to 3 generations they are there. They want to know where is our root. So there I was invited, and a few points which I made out there, I will also mention here. See, just as a tree depends upon its existence and growth, its root, particularly the mother root, what is called. And it is only when the mother root is healthy, the tree grows. But if you cut off the root, how can the tree die? Similarly, if we cut off our cultural roots, and still think that we can build our nation through by money power or political power. It is impossible, because the entire sustenance this our national life receive is from our cultural roots. And see, for all our political, social and economic problems, the samskar is the answer. Now let us take up the social problems. Social problems today are many. And now the individuals who are coming out of the schools, Jagmohanji pointed out, there's a lot of, we have got problems of educated men who are totally perverted. And we should not get confused between literacy and education. The difference is this. Many of our mothers are illiterates, but they are highly educated. My own mother, I can tell, and that is the position of so many people, their mother, they are illiterate. But my mother was able to recite Bhagavad Gita verses and tell what is the principle there. Recite Ramayana and tell what are the qualities which we have to learn from Ramayana. Recite instant stories from Bharata and tell a boy or girl what should be the ideal in life. So this is education. But unfortunately, we are going important illiteracy. What is the use of men becoming literate, men or women? And we have got many literary figures, but highly uneducated about our cultural values. That is our problem. You see, in Dharma, Ahimsa Satyam Asteyam Shaucham Indriya Nigraha. This is the rules of Dharma. It has nothing, not confined to any individual. You must be non-violent in your behavior. You must be truthful in your day-to-day life. You must not earn illegitimate wealth. Asteya and control of senses. These are the fundamental rules of Dharma. And in Mahabharata, there is one very useful rule of Dharma, which is actually covered by not making illegitimate wealth, but is found in Samvibhaga. Mahabharata says, Akrodaha Satyavachanam Samvibhaga Kshamayatha. Samvibhaga means sharing wealth with others. If a person is an industry or a businessman, he has to share his wealth with his employer and not to swallow the money for himself and leave and pay only paltry wages to the individuals. And then another important is, what is the conduct of an individual? There is one Hitopadesha. It says, Shlokardhena Pravakshami Yadartham Grantha Kotabhi. I will tell you what you should do, how you should mold your life, of what is contained in this innumerable text. In half a sentence, he says, Paropakara Punyaya Papaya Parapidanam. See, you do Paropakara, that is your dharma, and Parapidana, that is exploiting other individual for the sake of his own benefit, that is bad. Therefore, you should not do it. In nutshell, and Mahatma Gandhiji, as I said, he said, we must preserve our cultural values, otherwise nation will be committing suicide. And he said, there must be one of the most important quality, the preaching Mahatma Gandhi made, you must be truthful in your life, you must be non-violent, and the most another important which has a bearing on economy is simple life. Yesterday in the governing council also, I said Mahatma Gandhi, Mera Jeevan Mera Sandesh. How I am actually living is the message which you can take from me. Now he has given the simple life. Now what has happened is, now after independence, the simple life has given a go-by, particularly those holding political offices. Ostentatious life has become their activity. This simple, Mahatma Gandhi said, lead a simple life. And our Mahabharata says, Dharmaya Raja Bhavati Nakama Karanaya. The political power is meant for ruling the state according to law and not for enjoying luxuries of life. This is Shanti Parva. And now, the ministership is only meant for enjoying luxuries of life and not for ruling according to law. If I rule according to law, what is it that I am going to get? This is the type of people we have developed in this last 40 years. Unfortunately, our planners did not realize, even for implementing all these five-year plans, we must have a fundamental plan, namely man-making, what Vivekananda said. That is samskar. If you give good samskar, you will have good individual. If you have good individual, and then we will have a good national life. And then I coming to parivar. Now in imparting samskar, the family has got the, family has been institution earlier. A children, from childhood, they would get education. They would get the shlokas of Pratasmaran. The parents were imparting that. They were getting shlokas which imparted, for instance, even when I was in childhood, my father said, Uttaram yat samudrasya himadresya ivadakshinam, varsham tad bharatam nama bharatiyetra santati. This is, then apiswarna mayi lanka namai lakshmana rochate, janani janma bhumishta sargadati giri. And then, the first starting of vidya, in at the third year, there is, that is vidyabhyasa, prarambha. Then the first verse which we are told was, Namaste Sharada Devi, Kashmira Puravasini, Tvamaham Pratiya Devi, Vidyadanancha Dehime. And two things are there. Namaste Shara, we are worshipping the goddess Saraswati and invoking her blessing to give me vidya, not literacy mere, vidya. And then Kashmira Puravasini, you see national integration. A boy in the south starts his education with Namaste Sharada Devi, Kashmira Puravasini. And Jagmohan pointed out, there are people who say, Kashmir, you headache, give it away to, or partition it. It is just like saying, if there is headache, chop off the head and give it away. See, Kashmir, I am really amused when say the Kashmir people will decide its future. It is not the Kashmir, it is the part and parcel of this great country, Kashmir to Kanyakumari. And no part of this country can decide for its future, just as no limb of our body can determine whether can right hand or left hand or head or leg cannot decide, I am going to remain with the body or not. They can't remain separately at all. And in that vidyabhyasa beginning itself, that Kashmir is part and parcel of our nation and territory was being taught. But where is that education now available? Family parents have no time. By the time father is going to his job, the child would not have woke up from the bed, and by the time he comes back, it has gone to bed. Doesn't get any education from the father. If mother is also a working woman, then she will also not able to give any education. Now this is the biggest problem. Earlier the samskar was being imparted by the family. That is the greatest responsibility laid down. In fact, there are four pious obligations and four ashramas which are prescribed by our ancestors. That is runais chaturbhis sanyukta jayante manamavahi pitru devasya manajai deyam tebhyascha dharmatah. This is in Mahabharata Adiparva. There are four pious obligations to be discharged by an individual. One is towards the creator, that is gratitude towards God, and one is towards parents, the other is towards teacher, the fourth is towards the manavaruna. It is the entire society. Now they also said, how you are going to discharge this burden? Devaruna, by praying to God and by religious sacrifices, the other three are most important. Pitruna, how you are going to discharge? You have to discharge Pitruna, not by merely getting a son to perform the Shraddha of the father. It is not the discharge of Pitruna. The Pitruna has to be discharged by getting son or daughter, educating them, imparting good samskar to them and leaving them as to the society as good individual. That means they will become an asset to the nation and not liability, what is happening today. Today many youths, major portion of the youths have become alcohol addicts or drug addicts, and they have become liability not only on the family but on the nation. If you take just a statistic, 60-70% of the college going youths are becoming alcohol addicts and drug addicts. Who is going to give protection to them, if not father and mother? That is why the responsibility of mother to look after the children is so great, and it is he, she and she alone can be a watch and ward for a baby or a child or a boy or a girl and impart good samskar. And that is why they said these are the four pious obligations. And the third is Rishiruna. Rishiruna is acquisition, dissemination of knowledge. Professor Kishorilal Sarkar, in his Tagore Law lecture, I said, the Hindu society has considered this as the most sacred obligation and which has been discharged assiduously for centuries. Acquisition of knowledge and giving, just as when we take loan, we discharge it with interest. When we acquire knowledge from our gurus, we have to give it to the society with research and with additional knowledge, with commentaries, and our, you know, I need not explain how our ancestors, for 1,000 years before, the Sanskrit literature, the treasure which contains, is sufficient for the entire world for till the sun and moon last. Such a valuable literature our ancestors. Because even though writing and the other facilities were not there, even by transmission from individual to individual, family to family, they have protected this culture. And that is why this is the Rishiruna. And the third is, the fourth is Manavaruna. That is, you have to render service to humanity, because I am enjoying all the facilities of life because others have, whether I have got microphone, whether I have got vehicle, whether I have got road, house, or a beautifully constructed house. Who are constructed? The laborers, building workers, who live in some huts or jiggies, they have constructed. So when all those people are contributed to my happiness, it is my duty to render service to them. This samskar, this quality must be imparted to an individual. And in doing that the women, the family has got an important role. It is a joint responsibility. That is why the many people, I studied several smritis when I writing about the book of Indian, ancient Indian jurisprudence. No divorce is provided for. Do you know what is the explanation? Divorce is impossible, therefore it is not provided for. Because the relationship of husband and wife, once established, it is inseparable. That is why Manu says, Anyonyasya avyabhicharo bhaveda maranantikaha yesha dharma samasena jneyastripumsayo paraha. He says, mutual love and mutual loyalty. Many times he said, Pativrata, Pativrata. Our smritis are both Pativrata, Patnivrata. Dono vipat kaha hai. Mutual love and mutual fidelity is the dharma to be observed by husband and wife throughout their lives. There is nothing like temporary probationship. Now people think of temporary probation after which you can discharge. That is not available. And because the entire our foundation of our society is based on other important value, gratitude, kritagnyata. Now, one of the delegates, I think Pustana Arthanaji said, the family life is inseparable relationship has been established. Therefore, husband and wife, there is a joint responsibility to be discharged. It is not individual. Both of them, if husband and wife get separated after 2 or 3 years when 1 or 2 children are there, how are they going to discharge Pitruna? How are they going to discharge Rishiruna? How are they going to discharge Manavaruna? It is impossible. And how are they going to produce good citizens for the future? That is why I said, and then I give Duncan M. Durrett, an English author, has written a book here about the Hindu Marriage Act which provided for divorce. Do you know what he has written? The title of the book is Death of Hindu Marriage. He has written, these parliament members who have passed this law have not understood the ABC of the family value, and which have been laid down by the rishis, and they are destroying the families by introducing divorce. This is what Duncan M. Durrett has said. That is, I will give you an example. Here, suppose husband and wife, they have got already 2 children, a son and daughter, and divorce is given. Now you say, for these 2 children, they are brother and sister, correct. He is father, correct. She is mother, correct. But they are not husband and wife. Is it not contradiction? Father and mother, correct. But husband and wife, no, they have got divorce. Now, this is on account of displacing the value of gratitude by throwaway attitude. This is called throwaway culture in America now. In Future Shock, the book has been explained. Throwaway. You can use one article, color TV or black and white TV or some other computer or even a car. You have a old Fiat car, but Silo comes, throw away Fiat, take Silo. You have another new color TV, throw away the earlier TV. If you have money, of course you can do it, but not by illegitimate means, but you can do it. This is the throwaway. But this throwaway culture is extended to family life. No, I was Raman Usha Vastanaji said, Urdhashramas are coming. It is an insult to our Hindu culture. The whole society is based upon gratitude. The father and mother are all right when they provide you good childhood, all happiness, clothes, and then education, fees, medical education, and doctor. And after he becomes a doctor, engineer, or lawyer, or a chief executive in a family. I've seen in several, in Bangalore also, Vruddhashramas has come. The mother, old mother or father stays there just as we send a cow to a pinjra pole. But the sons and daughters who are well off, they are in enjoying their life because of the purely throwaway culture. So long they are useful to me, they are all right. Otherwise, throw away. This is totally alien to our culture. And that is what Asthanaji mentioned, that Vruddhashramas are coming. It is a very sorry spectacle. Now, the discharging these four pious obligations are the four ashramas. I will explain this and conclude my speech. What are the significance of four ashramas? Then we have got Balyavastha, then we have got Grihastashrama, Vanaprasthashrama, and Sannyasashrama. Forget in what context they were established. But if you take the basis or the value with which these ashramas are established, it will be relevant for all times to come. The first ashrama, during that, it is expected that every student, boy or girl, completely engages, concentrates his mind on education. So from 9 or 10 age up to 24 or 25, there should be total concentration on education and acquiring knowledge. This is how Rishi Lunaya has to be discharged. See, the connection is, for every pious obligation, their life is divided. You have to acquire knowledge. It is one of your duty, and in order to that, you have to do it in your studentship. And then the Grihasthashrama is the place where you have to discharge the, here comes the role of the Parivara. During Grihasthashrama, you have to discharge all the responsibilities. You have to protect a person who is a student. You have to protect the persons who have become a vanaprasthi. You have to give support to a person who is in Sannyasashrama. Now this Vanaprastha and the others who are in childhood, their responsibility is on the Grihasthashrama. And as far as Sannyasi is concerned, that responsibility is rested on all Grihasthas, because it is not confined to each family. And the role of Grihastha is, he has to impart education to the younger generation. And if he has already acquired knowledge, if he is a teacher, he has to impart education to the future generation. And he has to carry on the family responsibility. He has to maintain all the social securities included in the family. Because you don't go to, in America and England, now they are realizing the social security measures, laws under which the old parents, uneducated or unemployed brothers, or widowed sisters, or the state takes the responsibility. And in Vishwasanga Sibar, last person once said, an European, English parliament member said, if we continue the social security measures, our economy will collapse, and the only solution is Hindu family system, where an earning member takes his responsibility and gives complete security to all the members of the family. So these are the responsibilities of a person. And Vanaprastha, what is it? After your economic activity is over, earning period is over, then think of Manavaruna. The fourth pious obligation has to be discharged in a greater measure. Though it has to be discharged at every stage of life, during Vanaprasthashrama, you have to totally take the responsibility of discharging Manavaruna. And that is the concept which has inspired Bharat Vikas Parishad to bring in the scheme of Vikas Samarpits. Vikas Samarpits is nothing but fulfill the obligation of Manavaruna through Vanaprasthashrama. You need not go to forest, because no, forests are also not available. It is not necessary to go to forest. Remain in the family, but give up economic activity and then start rendering service to humanity. That is the fourth stage. And therefore, for all this, family constitute the foundation, and in the family, women constitute the foundation. There is an interesting book, The Essential Teachings of Hinduism, by Kerry Brown. He's an English author. The book was published in 1990, Arrow Books Publication, London. I was really amazed that the way in which he has written that book, and he has understood our philosophy. And the preface, he says, the word Hindu was coined by Muslim rulers, Muslim invaders, to the dwellers of the Hindu Valley, to Indus Valley. But the culture, you see the what, but the culture which we now know as Hinduism and which Indians call as Sanatana Dharma predates that label by thousands of years. Dharma is not religion as the West understands. Tantra Maharati means the man, it is the obligation of a man to give protection to every woman at every stage of life, namely when she is girl, young girl, it is the father who should give protection. When she is married, it is the husband who should give protection. And when she is age, it is the son who should give protection. That obligation to furnish security of women is placed on men. And then says, what is the real meaning of this? You take that book, Essential Teaching of Hinduism, and read paragraph 238, where he has given this Manu verse and says, many people do not understand the meaning of the real meaning of this verse. The real meaning of this verse is not that woman is to be treated, kept under thumb, or she should be kept as a slave. The real meaning is the women should be given protection, because woman, every woman is treated as crest jewel of the family, most valuable jewel of the family. Just as most valuable jewel requires to be protected always, so also the protection should be given to women. And then adds, what is the role given to a woman? Just see, childbirth, not merely childbirth, child care, not merely child care, child education, and lastly, he has the use, transmission of cultural values to the children. Just as the mother gives her milk of the breast, she is going to transmit cultural values to the children. It is not possible by man. And he says, that is the reason why, having thrown so much of burden on woman, to ask her also to earn would be unjust. Therefore, she is relieved of economic responsibility. This is what he has understood. Why woman is not asked to earn? Because the responsibility is given to her also. It is not a part-time job. Do you think bringing up a child and making him a best, like a Subhash Chandra Bose or Shivaji or Maharana Pratap, is it an easy job or a part-time job? Says no. It is a whole-time job, and every minute a mother has to have care regarding her children, and therefore it is under the family system. Therefore, this is the responsibility given to woman, and this is a joint responsibility of the parivar, both the man and woman. And it is by this discharging these responsibilities only that we will be able to discharge our burden towards the nation. And lastly, what I have said in the speakers have stressed this as per Nirmalaji. Also pointed out about this Vruddhashrama, which is nothing but an ingratitude towards the parents. And family education, family forms the foundation of our social life. And United Nations in 1966 have formulated, they have said, family is the foundation of national life, and therefore every nation and every government has to take steps for strengthening the family. And that is why the place given to woman is most sacred. See, when we say Matru Devo Bhava, Pitru Devo Bhava, Acharya Devo Bhava, we say, that is, treat every mother as God, treat every father as God, your father as God, treat your guru as God. But we did not stop there. Treat every woman as mother. Matru Devo Bhava. Treat mother as your God, and treat every woman as the mother. Because it is by inculcating that feeling only, you can, respect for womanhood will be developed, and that the women, again, whatever onslaught is going on through TV or cinema or even actual life, what our onslaught is going on womanhood, therefore, that can be stopped. This is the only powerful antidote. That is why, if you put it in a nutshell, the principle is parityajed artha kamavyo satam dharma vardhito. The entire wealth and desires must be controlled by dharma. Then that is the samskara which we have to impart to our children, and that is why mother is given such a higher place. You know, if a person becomes a sannyasi, he sarvasanga parityaga, he does it and he becomes a sannyasi. The father has to touch the feet of the sannyasi, but as far as the mother is concerned, the sannyasi has to touch the feet of the mother. There, it is impossible to get rid of the obligation or the gratitude towards the mother. That is why Shankara had promised that, though I have become a sannyasi and I being the only son, I promise you that I will discharge my obligation. Ultimately, I will come for your cremation, and he did come. And Matrustava, he has composed, where he says, "O mother, you have kept me in for 9 months in your womb, and you have given birth without taking so much of pain. And you have looked after me, you have educated me, you have given so much of knowledge to me. And what is it that I can do for you? It is impossible to discharge the debt of gratitude, but all that I can do is put a few dry rice into your mouth after your death." That is how the meaning runs, Matrustamana. That is the values which you have to cultivate in our younger generation. Nowadays, because of this cultural pollution, as I said yesterday in the governing body, this water pollution and air pollution, they spoil the life of the health of an individual. But this cultural pollution is going to pollute the entire national life, and if we don't take it, it will destroy our culture. And if our culture is destroyed, we must strengthen the character of an individual, and by strengthening family and individual, we can build a safe and strong national life.